Hey everybody, thanks for being here. This week it's big and dirty high water conditions for winter steelhead. Always be sure to wear your life jacket. Now if you want to learn how to catch more fish, stay tuned. I'm Justin Wolf and this is Angler West Television.
That's a fish.
Today we're hunting winter steelhead in big high water conditions.
All right, baby, there he is.
But Big Dave, Nick Popov, and Sam Parker are up to the challenge.
Oh, here we go. Then I tried to knock him off!
Right on. Yeah, buddy.
Winter steelheading on the Oregon coast is just starting, so we'll have an open mind about what to use and how to fish the river, since high water events have certainly changed the river since last year. But big beads typically work well in high water.
All right, good morning, everyone. We just got the boat in. This is Nick and I's first day for 2022.
Yeah, baby.
And it's, let me tell you, it's as big and dirty as I fished this river before. So it's gonna be a real chore to catch some fish today, but I think we can do it. We're gonna, what did we do? We already started off with a mess. Look at that.
We got some good fishermen on board today.
Yeah. Oh, we're using the tangle here, the tangle method.
I thought the Dave Tangle Free Weights helped with that.
Yeah, they're supposed to fix it.
It didn't work.
Is that how our season's going to start, Nick? Our first cast, we just tangled ourselves.
Well, you know, it's prepping us. It's getting us ready.
That's a good sign, guys.
So we're running B&R soft beads today. These are, I'm actually running some 20 mil. Like Dave said, it's huge. It's big and dirty. Maybe as big as I've ever fished it. Water color's okay, but I think we're going to find some success here today as soon as I can get this untangled.
We'll see. First day that me and Nick have fished this year. Sam's been out a couple of times, but we weren't quite prepared to fish clients in this high and dirty of water, but we're going to do our best to catch some fish for you guys today.
Well, we're going to find them.
We're going to have to pull out all the tricks today in this big water. We're really gonna be concentrating on the edges and the very back of the tailouts. We might even catch some that, you know, is gonna be dry ground in a few days as this thing drops. We're gonna run big presentations. What do you got on there, Nick? He's got a double.
I got a couple B&R soft beads, 20 mils. I'm running the double right now. I'm gonna start with it, but I may go down to a single. It just depends on kind of how the day goes.
Perfect. Scent, we're gonna run some scent today too, guys.
So yeah, we've got very high water today, as Dave has said, but it's dropping quick. So as high as it is, 6 hours from now it can be 4 or 5 inches lower, and that can make a big difference as the day goes on. So we're gonna work this slow, we're gonna work it real good, and we should be able to find them.
You know, we're in this pretty colored water right now, but it hasn't been raining for about 6 hours, so we are gonna see a pretty good drop. It's on the drop right now. You know, we're not in this huge hurry. It's early in the morning as this water warms up. You know, even if you get like a 1 degree temperature rise, they'll activate. You can get them to bite. So we're just gonna kind of be pretty methodical and hit every little soft pocket we can, get a few casts. If we don't get one, we'll move on. There is a lot of more places they can be when it's higher water like this. But where they're not gonna be is out in this big, fast stuff. They're gonna be on the edges and in the slow water.
Right where my bobber is.
There's one in here. Got this little creek coming out here. It's gonna have a nice little seam. A little clear water and it's soft. It's the kind of stuff we're looking for today. Not too deep too. So it's our first day back in, especially since we've had some big high water events. So it always takes a little bit on your first trip or so to figure out where the new snags are. The river will change a little bit, gravel will move around. It was a big learning day for us. You know, big dirty water. We put some scent on this bead, but we're gonna go ahead and put some meat on it too. We're gonna run some shrimp. A little more scent in the water. Get the old bait button on there, hold that down. Get the old bait button on there to hold that down. Boom. There we go. A little bit bigger, a little bit more for them to see out there. Tell you, you get these bobbers down below you like this when they're way down in front of you, Don't set the hook when it goes down. You just want to drop that tip and reel 1,000 miles an hour until you're tight on that fish, then come up.
Not from being cold.
No, it's not. What is it, 60 degrees out this morning?
I know, it's about as warm as it gets out here.
I think we had the old Pineapple Express, right?
Yeah.
What do they call this?
That's what happened. We had all that snow. We had a big snowstorm, and we really didn't get a ton of rain. It's just that you get all that snowpack up on the top, and then it melts with that rain, and it creates this river just, and you can see it's almost a glacial color. It's not really that muddy, you know, brown water you would typically see with rain and mud coming off the banks. And so I think that's what we're dealing with, is more like a glacial runoff type situation. And I don't know, it looks good. I think we're gonna find, oh, what was that? Oh, did you see that?
Yeah.
Welcome back to the Oregon Coast. I'm Justin Wolf. We're with Big Dave, Nick Popov, and Sam Parker, looking for the needle in the haystack with large beads, bait, and brightly colored plugs. Anything to get the attention of the fish.
So this Spro plug right here, with this high off-color water, this orange color shows up real good. I'll show you real quick. You can see it almost glowing in that dirty water right there.
This is pretty funny. Brandon just sent us all our stuff, and this came in the mail. He thought it'd be funny to put some Big Dave customs on there.
At least there's no carrots in there.
Yeah, at least there's no carrots in this one. Brandon. So there's a lot of different colors, and it can be overwhelming, you know, with all the different colors that come. Brandon makes an incredible lineup at B&R. You know, some of my favorites would be like the creamsicle, the clown, especially in this high dirty water, this clown, this sweet pink cherry is an amazing one.
Is probably one of my favorites right there.
Yep,
good old Cherise. That's a great one.
That's an incredible one. He makes this line of clowns too, these jokers, that you got the lighter. It's basically resembling a live egg pattern and a dead egg pattern. So you kind of have the whole spectrum. You know, you have your really bright oranges for a fresh egg. And then as they sit in the water, they tend to dull up and get whiter. And so you have the whole spectrum of color, and he does just an incredible job, man. And in my opinion, the soft beads are just a little bit better, because what happens is those fish grab onto a hard bead, it's instantly, you know, it's like a rock in their mouth. When they inhale a rock, they spit it back out. And so with this, it has a little bit of, you know, bounce to it, and they tend to hang on to it just a tad bit longer, in my opinion.
Yeah, and it's pretty crazy, you know, how many beads we have and how many different color options, but it really is. There's times where they key into one color and that is what they're gonna bite. So, you know, it's definitely good to have an arsenal, because there are days where they key into one bead and that's the one you gotta have on.
Yep. And if you don't have that one bead that day, there's an opportunity you're missing out on fish. And I mean, Dave's seen it many a times where it's just one specific color makes all the difference in your day.
Yep.
Okay, you can see we're working this tail out right here, and it's real important, you know, when these fish could be this far back in these things in very shallow water, that when you get to the back of it, you know, you kinda wanna let it swing through a little bit. And even when you're reeling in, you want to be almost sneaky, like when you're fishing in clear water, you know, reel out slow, even though it's shallow water. I mean, we'll get these fish that'll grab them on your reel in on the first couple of cranks that you give that reel as that thing starts to straighten out. But, you know, you definitely, this is where these fish are going to be.
So guys, as you can see here, there's a little different setup. Dave was just talking about the tail out, and before we were talking about casting really tight to the bank. Well, this sets up perfect. And these fish can kind of, as you can see, this current slows as it gets down to the back. And these fish will sit in the softer water because there's not as much force in there. So we're running out. You can cast a little further off the bank here because the water's still nice and slow. And it's a little shallower too. So it just sets up good. This is one of those spots where you could fish a little further off the bank versus being right next to it.
Nope. All right. You know, there's two sizes for the bait buttons. This is the smaller size, the original size. Then there is the larger size. But, you know, definitely when I'm running bigger hooks, bigger baits, I like the larger ones, but on this Steelhead, smaller stuff, these guys are great. There you go, we're gonna double down here, we're gonna double up here. Little meat, little bead.
Big river, big river.
Fish on.
It's a trout. No, it's not. I don't know what.
It's not a trout. No trout, is it?
I don't know. It's big, but it felt like a trout when I set the hook.
Okay, so here, hang that up. So we'll see here, Nick. I can tuck into where we're going to go.
That was the weirdest thing ever, dude. It was like a cutthroat when I set the hook. It was like, I don't know what I got.
Hey, I'm going to tuck in here. You might be able to net him right now in just a second.
It's a big hatchery fish. Yep. I'm going to go ahead and switch to Sam since I've already got one.
Let's find out what's going on.
All right, so we just hooked this fish kind of in this little spot we were going to anchor. Dave was telling us there could be one sitting there. And sure as heck, I put it through there and fish ate it. Looks like a beautiful hatchery fish.
Yeah, that drag's pretty
sensitive. So we're going to see if we can get a stab at this guy right now.
Oh, nice, nice fish.
Oh, yeah.
Beautiful fish.
But I handed that rod to Sam because I've already tagged a fish, and if I catch this fish and tag it, then I'm no longer able to fish, so I'm not ready to quit yet.
Not quite yet.
Good job, Sam.
Forward.
Rod low that way.
Rod low. Give me a lift.
Got him.
Oh! That one's down the hatch.
Today we have tough conditions on the Oregon coast, but the right presentation will get the job done.
Got him.
That one's down the hatch.
That's a nice fish. We'll pop him in here, guys, and I'm going to get his...
Look at how far that thing's got it down his throat in that slow water like that. I mean, it's just down there.
Boy, this steelhead took it deep, man. It took it deep.
All the way in there. Great. Great.
He probably liked it a little bit.
All right, so they're doing... We're what? 50-50. We've had action on the bead.
Bead.
And on the bait.
Yep.
The yarn there, so...
Well, I thought it was two on the yarny, but it turned out to be the beaded, actually, yeah. That first one bit. So pretty cool. So that fish was on a bobber dogging setup. So what I got here is just a fish build float, obviously in this big, big water. I'm running the large float. It's going to allow me to fish a little bit more weight and slow it down just a tiny bit. Down to a three-way swivel with a Dave's Tangle Free. These things are incredible, man. They just work so good. They kind of keep, I think, steel... moves smoother along the bottom without getting hung up, and so those things are really, really efficient in that way. And then I'm just going down to my yarny here, so I just got a yarn ball tied up with an egg loop on it, so that way we can add some shrimp with a bait button on it. And then we'll go down to a B&R soft bead, 20 mil B&R soft bead here, and I'll show you guys how I tie this knot, because it's a pretty cool little knot and there's a reason I use it. So you might not be able to see the knot itself, but I just doubled the line up. It's kind of like the Duncan loop. It's just slightly different. I got scent all over my hands. And then I just wrap back down towards the knot. And then you take that tag in and go back through that little loop you made. And then you just kind of snug it up and it'll create this loop. And it's really cool because once you attach this loop and snug it down, I like to pull it tight and then pull the tag in tight. But once you create this loop on the hook there, I can put some pressure on this knot, and don't do it with your teeth. Your dentist will probably get upset, but I like to, then it leaves that little loop. So I can take this thing on and off, and it's really cool when you're adding like a shrimp to this. You put your shrimp on, your bait button on, and then just slide your loop back on and you're back in business. So super easy and efficient way. And then I'll grab my 20 mil soft bead here. And then with these, I have an inline bead tied on there. So is what I'm gonna do is I'm just gonna try to get this as centered as possible and try to keep it as centered as possible so it doesn't wobble and tangle on you. And then I just go nice and slow so the rubber doesn't get burnt and tore up. And then that just sits right above there like so. And that fish will grab it, hook pulls through, and just grabs them in the corner of the mouth every time. It's awesome. Most efficient way, great technique for high water.
You could probably throw that inside, Nick.
heads up.
Ready, buddy.
Oh, there it is! Come on! Come on!
It's not a fish.
Dave!
There he is! There he is!
That's a fish for sure. Yeah!
There he is!
You called that one too, dude?
I was just sitting right on that seam right there. Woo. Right on that seam, buddy.
Well,
let's see. Nice. Well, let's see. Hold on here. He doesn't really know what's going on yet so much.
I think he has an idea.
Yeah, there he goes.
Oh, yeah.
Cool little jump.
Get down.
There we go.
He's on the old beater.
Whoa. Perfect. Oh, I remember how to do all this, huh?
I know.
Steelhead fishing. The bobber went down.
Even with the bait caster, I like it.
The bait caster gone.
That's it. Oh, it's on the bead.
Yep, on the bead, this one.
The old B&R. Soft bead strikes again.
Sweet.
That was cool.
Oh, we were looking for a little one, right?
Yeah, this might be him.
This might be it. Not in the net yet, though. Not in the net yet, though. Okay, I'm going to put him in there. Ready?
Yep.
This will be like a circus game. Maybe. Whoop, whoop, whoop. There he is. And hello, little guy.
There he is.
All right. What do we got?
I think it's a little wild.
It is a little wild.
Welcome back to the Oregon coast. I'm Justin Wolf. Big Dave has hooked a smallish wild steelhead, a valuable asset to the broodstock program and to the future of the fishery.
And hello, little guy.
There he is.
All right. What do we got?
I think it's a little wild. It is.
It is a little wild. He is a little wild. God, we should probably put him in the tank, huh?
Yeah.
Sweet. All right, guys. Well, we brought our broodstock tank today, so we're going to go ahead and get that thing prepared, and yeah, we'll put this guy in the tank.
Sweet. Ooh, that's a good one, too, because this is a really good one for the early fishery fish. It's real important that we get fish in here the early time of the year, you know, in the earlier months. And this one's already somewhat ripe, yeah. Got a little color to him. He'll be real good. He'll be able to be spawned earlier than a brand new one fresh out of the ocean. It takes them longer to develop.
Yeah, and remember too, that was the other thing. If you just put big ones in.
Yeah, it doesn't work.
Yeah, you got to put all sizes in so they come back every year instead of those big ones. A lot of times they'll stay out a lot longer.
Five salt fish and stuff. So they were telling us it's really important to spread it out, get big ones, small ones. Just basically, especially this early, it's really important just to start the foundation of it, get the ball rolling. So,
sweet. Awesome.
All right. Well, let's get the tank ready. Sam, you want to start clearing the tank? There we go. So basically, this is just an aerator system. It's got a little pump down here, a little bilge pump, and it's got a little suction cups and a little stem here with holes in it that creates oxygen for them. So that'll just keep them in there. They'll stay super lively. And they'll just kind of swim around. Once this gets closed, it will.
He'll calm down.
The fish will just calm down in the dark, and he'll just be there perfectly. And when we go to, it's unbelievable how lively they can be when you go to pull these things out.
Yeah, they can
the
like
tank.
Slap you right in the face.
Right in the face.
I got whacked pretty good here last year.
It was a little bigger than that.
Yeah, a little bigger than that one.
That's funny. We did it.
Not bad for our first day.
And not bad for giant water.
Big, scary water.
Scary water at times.
Yeah.
Boy, right. That's crazy. Well, we're going to head on down, go take this fish, put it in the broodstock tank, kind of show you guys how that's done, and we'll see you here in just a second putting a fish in there.
Here we go.
This is the check-in sheet. So every day we'll come in here after we catch a fish. We log it for ODFW to come in here. You'll put down the date, male or female, your name, and how many fish you caught that day. And then basically you update the board, and that allows the people, or when they come in and they pull the fish out of the trap, how many fish they're looking for, and they know an exact count. So they pull the correct amount of number of fish, and then they take them over to the hatchery, and they'll take these fish and they will live spawn them. They'll keep them alive all the way till they're ready to spawn. The cool part about this program is when they're done spawning them, they return them back to this river, the same river.
We catch them again.
And we catch them again. It's incredible. I've caught multiple fish from previous years
One fish 2 years ago was from the 3 years prior. Right. Still had a tag in the back of it. And, I mean, it's just really neat to see the program working and being so successful. So
we haven't had a closure since?
No, 24 years or something like that. And it's because of this program. I mean, you know, the guys who originated this, Jack Smith and those guys, this is, I mean, they're the founders of it and just amazing people. Buzz Ramsey, all those guys, just a big part of this program. And so it's our footsteps, follow up and help. And there we go. Let's go put one in there.
I like it. I like to set them in here, get them in there, and let them rest for a second.
In the net.
Yep. Oh. There he goes.
Boom.
Out.
Right as I put the net in the water, he was ready to go. So that's good news.
So they'll keep them in this pin for a couple days. Basically, some days they'll pick them up same day. They pick them up every other day during the week. And then the following Monday, so the hatchery will come down here. They'll take them out of this tank here where it's pumped directly from the same river they came from. So it's actually their acclimation water here. And then they'll pull them out of here, go up there, spawn them, bring them back, and let them go back in the river. And then they'll take all the eggs and the milk and create more fish for us to catch as anglers. So awesome program.
Absolutely.
Another great thing about this program, guys, is, you know, all these fish, we catch rod and reel. So as we spawn these fish and they come back, you know, their parents were all caught rod and reel. So they have it in the bite. They have that gene to bite, where some fish, as we know, just don't bite.
Well, and there's a lot of programs out there besides these programs that will do a broodstock program, but they are trapped at a dam.
Yeah,
and they take
netted.
Those fish or net them, and then they take those fish and do the same process. But they're not the biting fish. They're the fish that have moved in through the tide shot straight up to the hatchery deadline. They scoop those fish and then move on. It's having biting fish, it creates a biting spawn, and it's really incredible.
Good genes. It's all about good genes.
That's right.
Our first day in, big, huge, dirty water.
Yep. And fish.
Kind of was a bead, maybe 50-50, I guess, on the bead.
The bead seemed to be working.
Yep.
Like it always does in this high water like this.
Hey, thanks for making the time to watch today's episode, and I hope it was time well spent. Now, if we can help you out with your own fishing, be sure to stop into the Angler West store in Woodland, Washington. And remember, without our sponsors, there is no show. So please thank them when you can. Now, get out there and do some great fishing.